Well, 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 good morning, City Point Church. Oh, it's so good to see everybody in the house of the Lord this morning. My name is Dave. I'm one of the leaders here at City Point Church, and I just want to welcome all you guys here in the house and all of you watching online. It really pleases us that you choose to gather with us for Sunday morning worship. It's so good to come together as a family to worship our Lord. Just a quick reminder for all those members only. Please hang out after service for an announcement for you guys, so you don't want to miss that. Please stand with me as we prepare our hearts for worship. We come today to worship the God who became a man. The Creator emptied himself and became a servant of his own creation. The immortal God humbled himself as mortal, even to the death on a cross. So now Christ is exalted above all. Every knee bows and every tongue worships before his glory. We join all creation in confessing that Jesus Christ, the God who became a man, is Lord of all. Let's worship our Lord.
Third week of Advent, we light this candle in hope. We light this candle for peace. We light this candle. Enjoy. To all who dwell as strangers in a time of shadows, to those bound as wanderers by the oppression of others, and to those who find themselves estranged from their true God-promised selves because of sin, the Lord speaks of joyful news. Zephaniah 3:14-20. Sing aloud, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has cleared away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall never again fear evil. On that day, it shall be said to Jerusalem, Fear not, O Zion. Let not your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst. A mighty one will save you. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing. I will gather those of you who mourn for the festival, so that you will no longer suffer reproach. Behold, at that time I will deal with all your oppressors, and I will save the lame and gather the outcast, and I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time I will bring you in, at the time when I gather you together, for I will make you renowned and praised among all the peoples of the earth. When I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord, let us pray. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord is my strength and my might. God has become my salvation. With joy, you draw water from the wells of salvation, and you will say in that day, Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say, rejoice. Sing praises to the Lord, for God has done gloriously.
the joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy, the joy, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy, the joy, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy, the joy, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy. listen closely, hear him calling out your name. He is here, you can touch him, you will never be the same. He is here, holy, holy, he is here, amen, he is here. For the person in the room that feels so lonely during this holiday season, Lord, would you be with them this morning? Would you be their Emmanuel? They came here with hungry hearts, desperate for you to be with them. So Holy Spirit, would you come and would you encounter them differently? Would Emmanuel mean something to them in this holiday season? That our hope is forever in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Mary Pflug. I'm one of the leaders here at City Point Church. And here at City Point, we want to know who Jesus is, we want to live as Jesus says, and we want to do as Jesus does. That's our heartbeat. That's our mission. So we just want to say welcome. We're so excited to have you in the house of the Lord this morning. Kids, this is your favorite part. It's our Christmas party today. Woohoo! We get to celebrate the reason for the season, and you guys get to go on my left, on your right. Woohoo! Christmas party. It's going to be the best. Kids ministry rocks. It's so fun. Yes. Okay, one more coming. Go for it. All right. Cheer them on. Woohoo! All right, and we're going to go ahead and go into a time of fellowship, so make sure you go ahead and say hello. Thank you.
please stand for the reading of God's word? The reading is from Matthew 1:17. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations, and from David to the deportation of Babylon, 14 generations, and from the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, guys. You may be seated. Well, the Christmas season is officially here. We are going to be celebrating in the next upcoming days here the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Aaron. I'm one of the leaders here at City Point Church. And for those of you who are joining us online and here in the house, we just want to say welcome. So before we dug in today, I figured that we'd start at a really cool place, a story from my wife and I's first Christmas together. Here's why this is a cool place, because, it's cool for her, it's not cool for me, because I totally embarrassed myself. But this is what happens when you're first married, and I'm going to use the football analogy. So this was our rookie year, okay? This is the rookie year. So here's the thing, I was her first round draft pick, so naturally as a first round draft pick, naturally what you want to do is you want to impress the coach, and she's the coach, and so naturally you want to impress the coach and really show up and come out swinging really in a big way. And so I remember our first Christmas together, she gave me a list of the things that she wanted. And I looked at that list and I said, I know you better than that list. I'm going to go ahead and get everything that's not on this list that I think that you love and that you know. And so she went back and forth with me on this. She goes, I don't know, babe. This is one of those things where I have these specific things picked out and this is what I want for Christmas, right? This is like a give me. And I'm like, no. There are no give me's right now. Let me go on ahead and go out and go hit this home run for you real quick. So we go out and we go shopping, and I go shopping for her stuff. She goes shopping for mine. Ironically enough, she actually followed my list of the things that I wanted and got the things that I wanted. I went rogue, which is a rookie mistake. Year one, guys, do not do this. This is a mistake, grade A mistake, okay? So I go out and I pick these things, and I don't even think I've told you this portion of it. So my thought process was, well, I'm just going to go pick the things that I think that my mom would wear, which that is a whole, you want to talk about, flag on the play, man. That was a terrible decision. So, I'm going, and I'm like, okay, well, I guess my mom will wear this, so I'm just going to go ahead and pick this out. And we go through these things, and we get to Christmas, and, man, I am grinning. I'm like, I knocked this thing out of the park. And so she starts opening up her gifts, and she starts going through, and, that thing, that individuals do when they receive a gift where, you know that they don't like it, but they're still going to, smile and be like, oh, this is great. So that's exactly what my wife did. She really just grinned and bared it throughout the entirety of opening up these Christmas presents. And then finally, as we get to the end of it, she literally looks at me and she goes, did you keep all the receipts? Happy holidays, right? So yes, I kept all the receipts. We ended up going and we ended up getting everything on her list, okay? We ended up getting everything on her list. So here's the lesson, here's the tie-in to this, okay? So in pride, because that was a very prideful posture that I myself took in this, thinking that I could just go out and I knew her better than she knew herself in this rookie year and go out and buy all the different things. I know, like listening back to it again, I was like, what was I doing? And so, going back and reflecting on this, man, I had such a prideful heart posture that I really wanted to try to prove myself that first Christmas. And I think a lot of times as believers, whatever our first Christmas may be in our modern context, man, we always just have this posture of just trying to prove ourselves in the faith and to make a name for ourselves. And that is a very dangerous game to play, especially because in this faith, it's not about making our name known. It's about making our Lord and Savior's name, Jesus Christ, known. And so this is what we get to talk about today in the exile to Joseph portion of the passage of Scripture. I'll read it to you, and I want you to listen to this. And so here we go in verse 12 in Matthew chapter 1. And after the deportation to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, and Shealtiel was the father of Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel was the father of Abiud, and Abiud the father of Achim, and Achim the father of Eliud, and Eliud the father of Eleazar, and Eleazar the father of Mathan, and Mathan the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called the Christ. You want to know what the crazy part about this portion of the genealogy is? Of all the names that are listed here, only three of them the Bible gives details about. Just three. Zerubbabel, Joseph, and Mary. That's it. All the other names that we just read through, all that we know, their whole story, their whole thing that was recorded inside of this book is just their name and that they were a father and a paternal figure in the line of Jesus. That's their story. And in pride, a lot of us say, well, I want more written about me. It's true. I mean, there's certain things I just don't want written about me. Like if you go back through the whole, all of God's word, yes, you have the stories of obedience from all these heroes of the faith, but you also have how they faltered and how they fell, and that is documented and recorded as well. Like it's a burden having your story recorded because you then become a testimony to both obedience and disobedience to God because there was nobody at this point in time until the arrival of Christ who could perfectly do the will of the Father and who could perfectly obey what God said. Again, we talked about last week with David. Man, even David, he was an individual who was a man after God's own heart. He did the will of the Father, but he perfectly didn't fulfill it, and he perfectly didn't obey it. So we're going to dive into these three names that we know. The first one is this, Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel, his name means the seed of Babylon. You might be wondering, well, why is this of any importance inside of the genealogy of Christ? So think about it like this with these names. These names were also titles. So it'd be like me introducing myself as Aaron. Let's pretend my name is Zerubbabel. I would literally introduce myself as, hello, my name is the seed of Babylon. Okay? That's how they would introduce themselves inside of the modern context. So, again, Zerubbabel was a descendant of, again, the kingship. So he was royalty. So instead of him being the seed of Jesse, or instead of him being the seed of David, he was now known as the seed of Babylon. And Babylon, that name means the gate of the gods. So his name really meant the seed of the gate of the gods. Why is that so important? Because he didn't allow the name that he was given to define him. He could have very easily, again, like think about it in the context of our last name. Our last name can sometimes carry some weight with it, both good and bad. Man, we can have our last name can have a terrible history attached to it. Just because you have that last name and just because you have a past doesn't mean that you have to live up to the failures of that name. And in Zerubbabel's case, he didn't live up to the Babylonian standard of worshiping multiple gods. He was also known by the Persian name Sheshbazzar. He led the first band of Jews out of captivity after 70 years that numbered 42,360. And in the second year of the return, he built an altar and laid the foundation of the temple on the ruins of that which had been destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar. So he started rebuilding the temple. He started doing things that were holy. His obedience to the prophetic word led to the people being obedient to the Lord. So again, he's in this posture of obedience. He's listening to what God is doing. He's not perfectly going to be able to do it because nobody can perfectly do the will of the Father except for Jesus Christ. But in humble obedience, he counts himself as nothing more than dirt, lowers his posture and says, God, I will do your will. And that is the example that we have to follow as believers in Christ. Again, guys, we're just dirt. From dust we were made, to dust shall we return. And so if we are humble, again, if we posture ourselves as lowly as the dirt in front of an almighty God, we are able to obediently go and do his will. And even though there are sufferings, even though there are challenges that come along the way, man, we are so able to just be in this rejoiceful posture and say, God, you are greater than I am. The devil plays on our pride. He plays on it every single day. Look at what you did. Look at all the things that you have done. And then also in the same vein, again, if you're looking at your last name and you say, man, my last name has a lot of just evil things attached to it and even good things attached to it, you might be looking at that last name. This is still the same posture of pride when we say, man, look at all the evil that somebody did in your last name. Or better yet, look at all the good that somebody did in your last name. And we become puffed up in both circumstances until we finally admit and say, my last name doesn't define me, only the name of Christ defines me. For those of you who are walking right now and being like, man, I know who Jesus is. I believe in him. Man, don't allow your last name to define who you are. There is a beautiful legacy that comes, again, from lines of believers, or even a more beautiful legacy when you see people walk into, again, this fellowship of believers who were once walking in darkness, they're now walking in the light. But you yourself, as a child of God, have to take that name and say, okay, I am a child of the Lord, I am a child of Jesus Christ, and I will follow and obey him, not obey the things of this world. And then out of this humble posture of obedience, we are able to go and continue to follow the will of the Father and do the things that he instructed us to do. The other individual who is named specifically in this genealogy that we have some background about is Jacob, as Joseph. His name means to increase. And we'll tie in these name meanings in a second with both Joseph and Mary. Here's what we know about Joseph. He was a carpenter. Okay, but let's get some important context for this. A carpenter, a lot of us think that it's just a woodworker. So the Greek word, which is tekton, can refer to either wood, stone, or metal. So he would have either been a woodworker, a stoneworker, or a metal worker. Either way, as a carpenter, you were doing a very laborious job. You were doing a lot of hard work. Bethlehem is his ancestral home. So he was, again, in Bethlehem, and he was betrothed to Mary. And then we get to see Mary now. The Hebrew name for Mary is actually Miriam. And so here's what that name means: rebellion. It's very interesting. We'll go through these things and we'll explain the meanings of increase and rebellion. So she was of the tribe of Judah in the lineage of David. Her cousin was Elizabeth, who was of the lineage of Aaron. And she was told by the angel Gabriel that she would be the mother of the promised Messiah. So here's the connection. And this is something that's very, very fascinating. Names have meaning and names have weight and names have importance inside of the Bible. Your name has an importance. And so if you look at the way that this is listed inside of the genealogy specifically, you have Jacob, the father of Joseph, who was the husband of Mary. Okay, these are the last two people who are mentioned before Jesus was born. All right? So here's the tie-in to this. If you look inside of all of the Bible, what do you see? You see an increase in rebellion, and then God delivers. Joseph's name means increase. Mary's name means rebellion. And Jesus does what? He saves. So if you go to the story of Noah, you have this increase in rebellion. What does God do? He preserves and he saves. Again, even at the time of Moses and the time of Egypt, what do you see? Again, you have this Pharaoh who is rebelling against God, and you see all this rebellion occur, an increase in rebellion. What does God do? He goes and he delivers and he saves. You have the judges in the sin cycle. You're able to see the people of Israel who are, again, acting out in rebellion. God raises up a judge to do what? To, again, deliver, to save after an increase of rebellion. Everything inside of God's word comes with intentionality, even the names. And that's why it's so imperative and important for us to understand what God's word says, but it's also imperative and important for us to understand really the two paths that we go in this life. And I want to show you these two. After this, of the other names listed, the Bible includes no details. Why is that important? Because their story was defined inside of the scriptures as an individual who was placed in a role for a specific time in the genealogy of Christ. And here's your reminder. Just because your deeds are not documented physically here on earth does not mean you failed to fulfill the purpose in the story that God has for you. Please don't forget that. Please don't think, man, just because like you're not remembered or you're not being inducted into the Hall of Fame, like you have, I don't know, the Bulls are about to go and induct like Jordan Pipkin and Phil Jackson inside of their Ring of Honor. Like just because you're not inside of a Ring of Honor right now does not mean that God does not see you or that you're not fulfilling your purpose here in this life. Again, God sees the deeds. We know that before we enter into eternity, again, all these deeds and the things that we've done in this life are going to be documented and going to be read off and understood by the Lord. So God sees us, God understands us, God knows exactly what we're doing. But man, like, it's not about what you accumulate here on earth. It's about how well did you live out the name of Jesus Christ and how obedient were you to him. And so there are two ways that we can go inside of this life. And I just want to remind you of this. Again, using the sports analogy, we have the concept of free agents. These are individuals after they get released from their contract with the team. Again, they think that they have this choice and be able to pick where they're going. So, however, in the story of God's word, there is no such thing as our equivalent of free agency. So you're doing one of two things, and this is how the ancients understood it. You're becoming either more like Christ or you're becoming more like the demons. There is no in-between. In pride, we stand here and we say, well, there's a little bit of a gray area for me. Like maybe today I'm feeling like becoming more like Christ and then I can camp out here. I can become more like the demons and I can just come over here for a little bit. Or better yet, I can stay here in a net neutral. The individuals who want to stand inside of a net neutral typically are those individuals who are atheists, who believe that there is no God. So that way I can just stand here in a net neutral position and say, okay, I don't have to pick either side. But all ancient cultures and every single ancient culture, if you go back and look at it, they had some form of deity that they went and worshiped. So atheism wasn't a thing until you start getting into the Reformation, the philosophical eras. So one of the things that we can easily understand and see is there are two lines of thought with this. Again, if you are a believer in Christ, you're either doing one of two things. You're becoming more like Christ or you're backsliding and regressing and becoming more like the demons. If you're an individual who does not know Jesus, and because you have sinful nature indwelling inside of you because of the fall that occurred when Adam and Eve were tempted by the devil, by the serpent, by the great deceiver, again, because sin entered into the world and death entered into the world, again, our natural tendency as human beings is to become more like the demons and become more fallen and fallen and fallen and fallen. Again, we are in a state of perpetual falling until Christ arrived. Again, until God was with us, until Emmanuel literally came, we were in a perpetual spiral of falling. And then we see when, again, Christ arrives and comes to the scene, man, holy cow, like we have the ability, again, to become more like the example that he set, and there is redemption that comes through that. So I want to paint this picture for you very, very clearly. Again, in this life, if you're a believer inside this room, you're doing one of two things. You're either becoming more like Christ, or when you sin and when you transgressed, and again, you're starting to become more like demons, but then you can repent of those sins and then still become more like Christ. That doesn't give you the excuse of going and sinning and continuing being in a perpetual state of, well, if I know God's going to forgive me, then I'm just going to keep on transgressing and transgressing and transgressing. That's just taking advantage of a gracious God. That's taking advantage of his mercies. God withholding the judgment that you do deserve. I want you guys to understand this and just be careful of this. Like, I'm not coming up here and preaching legalism to you. Like, you guys have to go up here and you have to do this set of rules, you have to do these set of things. But when you transgress and when you sin, I want you to understand the weight. That's becoming more like the demons. That is what the demons did. What did they do? They transgressed against God and then they fell. And so, but we have a beautiful God through the sending of his son, Jesus Christ, that God with us through his death, through his burial, through his resurrection that we see on the cross, we're able to enter into this fellowship of him where we can say, when I mess up, I can say, God, I repent of these sins. Will you please forgive me? And we exhibit the restoration process. And we continue to become more and more like Christ. So continuing on, this is what we also get to see as well. What the ancients believed in this. There was this ancient early father called John Chrysostom. Here's what he says. It is not the souls of those who die violently which become demons, but the souls of those who live in sin. Their nature as human beings is not changed, but their way of life imitates the wickedness of demons. That should sit heavy with us. Again, our natural posture before Christ, our natural posture before we enter into a relationship or a fellowship with him, when we're dwelling in sinful nature, we are imitating the wickedness of the demons. When we are in Christ, when we are set apart, when we are living a holy life, we are to be imitating Christ in the things that he did. We have God with us. He is active, he is here, he is moving, he is alive, and he is working miracles day in and day out. But yet sometimes we just, in pride, we say, man, I want to go follow the way of the demons. There was another early church father, his name was Antony the Great. And this is what he had to say particularly about the demons as well. The demons are aware that the devil fell from heaven through what? Pride. So they attack first those who are advanced in the way by trying to set them against each other through pride. In this way, they attempt to cut us off from God. So if we go back and if we go look and say, well, again, like, what was the posture in which, again, the devil fell out of heaven? Well, the posture in which he fell out of heaven was this. It was envy. He was envious of the worship that the Lord was receiving. But then here's what we end up doing. Again, through our human pride, the devil plays on that and the demons play on that and they say, man, look at how great you are. Like, look at what you're doing. Like, they're elevating your posture to the point that you become so haughty and prideful that you become combative and you become an antagonist inside of the church. And that is a dangerous place to be. Again, if we consider ourselves humble, again, if we were to be imitators of Christ, what was Christ? He humbled himself to what? The point of death. To the putting on of human flesh. The ancients understood it as this. When Christ came to this world, they called it the humiliation of Christ because he put on the same flesh that the creation had. And so therefore, again, we shouldn't be getting a posture of pride here, but man, we should be exhibiting a posture of humility if we are in Christ. But at the same point in time, we should not project the expectations of a believer on a non-believer. We have to understand, and this is why we're talking about this, for those of you who are actively witnessing in your respective ministry context, whether it be inside of companies, whether it be inside of your home, and everywhere in between. Man, if people are fallen, if people are broken, then they have this sinful nature, they are going to wrestle with pride. And so we should not force humility on people and say, man, oh, you need to be more humble. Oh, you need to be more downtrodden. Man, a sinful person who does not know the Lord, they don't know how to be humble. They don't know how to do it. And here's what we do. We get frustrated at that. Well, man, why can't you understand like how to be more humble? Like I understand it because you know Jesus and they don't. And even people who know Jesus will exhibit pride at times. And that's where we come in brotherly love and we say, man, dude, listen, you're being really prideful right now. I mean, like, that's biblical confrontation. It's found in Matthew 18. Man, being able to bring witness and say, brother, like, this is too much, man. You are stumbling. Like, man, we just want to make sure that you're okay. And we have the ability as a church to come alongside, to be able to reconcile, to see restoration occur. But man, the devil works through pride and he plays on our pride. So every single day we have to remind ourselves to be humble. We have to remind ourselves to humble ourselves before an almighty God. There's also the tension of becoming more like Christ. And again, when we hear stories inside of God's word, well, man, I want to become more like Christ. I want to be more like him. Man, there are times where I look at that and say, man, this is really hard. Like, Jesus was perfect. He lived a perfect life. He was tempted and tried exactly how we are. But man, like, there's sometimes where I look at it and go, dude, like, I can't fully do this perfectly. And I think that inside of our Western American context, man, the devil has done a really good job of blending perfection and obedience into one thing. They're two separate things. Obedience is looking at God's word and submitting it under an almighty Father and saying, okay, God, I'm going to go and be obedient to what you say. Perfection is I'm going to try to achieve this obedience and climb the ladder myself. There's no humility oftentimes in perfection. And I know that might sit hard and heavy with some people, but it's true. Like even in a job context, like, I don't want to be perfect in my job. I just want to be obedient to what my boss has told me to do. And again, this is my boss. This is what I'm going to go and do. This is what the Lord says. In the same vein, again, like, when you have all the instructions that have been given to you, man, you want to obey those instructions. And what's happened is because we've married, again, perfection and obedience together, we feel like, well, this is an unachievable thing. And the truth is, that's the point. You yourself cannot achieve, again this whole faith life yourself. It is only through Christ that you are able to walk in a humble, obedient relationship with him. And that's everything that the Bible screams. It proclaims this. It says, like, guys, apart from Christ, you can't do it. And that's okay. But here's what the enemy does. You can do it yourself. You can achieve. God will be so happy if you're just out there and you're perfect all the time. Man, that's not it. It's obedience. It's being imitators of Christ. There's a great passage in 2 Corinthians that I want to share with you right now. And this is Paul talking in the church of Corinth. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. So that old creation, that old sinful posture, that old sinful nature that you had, again, that old, it has passed away, but behold, the new has come. But now some of you inside this room are sitting here going, brother, I still struggle with sin. Like, I nowhere inside of God's word does it say that once you have Christ that you will stop sinning. It doesn't say that. Again, we are to be imitators of Christ. Again, the reason that we are called to be imitators of Christ is because if we didn't have to be imitators of Christ, that means that sin is completely wiped out completely once we receive Christ. But we know that sin won't be wiped out completely until we get to the end of the story and the beginning of the story for us when we see Jesus come back and annihilate the devil and annihilate sin once and for all. And in this life, our testimony, our burden is that even in Christ, we will still fall. That is the burden, that is the testimony, that is the weightiness of being a believer. We will still make mistakes, we will still fall, but we have this beautiful opportunity to humble ourselves before an almighty God and seek forgiveness for him. So I don't want you to believe the lie, well, I can't do this, like, there's no way, this is too much, it's just giving me anxiety, like, talking about it. Guys, all that this requires to be able to enter into a relationship with Christ is to be able to confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart about what he did. And that he rose again from the grave. But it requires a posture of humility to say that I can't do it, and the demons want you to believe that you can do it yourself. And so continuing on, this is what we also get to see as well. How do we become more like Christ? Like, what are these practical steps that we can take, that we can be, again, healthy and holy believers in Christ? How do we become more like him? Number one, be born again. One of the best stories that you will ever read inside of God's word is in the Gospel of John. And it's in John chapter 3 where Jesus is having a conversation with this dude named Nicodemus. And it is one of the coolest. I would encourage you guys, man, go and read this story. Again, Nicodemus is an individual who has an understanding of the Torah. He has an understanding of the prophets. Again, he knows what's written about the Messiah. And he's literally having a conversation with the Messiah. And I love this. I just love this conversation. So Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And then Nicodemus, man, I found myself being like Nicodemus time and time again. Like we're asking, again, this is a faith question right here. I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And oftentimes in my life, I immediately, instead of going to a place of faith, I go to a place of practicality. And I've tried to put limitations on what faith really looks like. And I've seen myself ask the same question that Nicodemus eventually asked Jesus, which was, well, how do I become born again? Like, am I supposed to crawl back up inside of my mom's womb and, like, be birthed again? Like, asking all these practical questions instead of really just submitting to the fact, okay, this is a step of faith. This is a step of belief that I myself must be able to take. And again, this faith has to be your own. It can't be a faith that you say, well, because from a generational standpoint, man, like my parents believe, therefore I believe. No, this faith is exclusive to you, to the individual. It is not something that is generationally passed along. We have the instruction inside of God's word to teach her and train our children up in the way that they should walk, lest they depart from it. Why do we need to do that? So that would be teach them the same faith that we ourselves, again, cling and hope to. So again, those first step is being born again. And then the second step is this. It is sanctification. Sanctification. One of the things that is the hardest about the Christian faith is the pruning and the refining process. So what is sanctification? Again, it really just encapsulates. Again, at the point of salvation, when we are born again, when we believe in what Jesus Christ did, again, when we commit and surrender our life to him, again, we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and the work of the Holy Spirit begins. And what we get to see is this beautiful process of refinement that requires surrender. It requires transformation that you yourself can't do. It's the Holy Spirit working inside of you. Again, that transformation occurs in this awesome human-divine partnership, the renewal of the mind, and proving the will of God. So where do we get all these qualifiers from? Where do we get all these things that make up what sanctification is? We get it from Romans 12:1-2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies, and mercy is God withholding the judgment that we do deserve, of God, to present your bodies as a what? A living sacrifice. Let's pause right there. A living sacrifice. If you are in Christ, you are being a living sacrifice. That means that you are sacrificing the certain desires of this flesh, the certain desires of the world that you really want to partake in. And you say, okay, God, I'm going to use my life as a living sacrifice, wholly committed to you. And again, after this, what's the next thing? Holy and acceptable to God. To be holy means to be set apart. So you are literally out of tune with the generation that you are living in. You're being set apart in the life that you are living. And acceptable to God. You have to be holy to be acceptable to God. And part of holiness is, again, submitting and saying, God, I believe in you, and I believe in what Jesus, your son, did, and I confess with my mouth that he is Lord. And then you enter into this beautiful pruning process for the duration of your days. Holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. We have a really bad misunderstanding about what worship is. Worship is this beautiful thing between you and God. And where the enemy wants to really sow seeds inside of the church and sow seeds inside of the believers is if we say, man, if I'm not getting anything out of worship, then it's not good worship. Here's the biblical understanding of worship. Worship is an offering that you as a believer are offering as a posture of praise and thanks to an almighty God. And then verse 2, this is what it says. Do not be conformed to this world. Again, the setting apart. But be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect, proving that you are doing his will. So transform, this transformative process begins. As you grow inside of your faith, as you open up God's word, as you spend time communing with him in prayer and in praise and lifting up of song, again, you begin to understand more and more about the nature of God and his character. That is the transformation process that occurs. Your role in that transformation process is being obedient to what God instructs and being a disciple of Christ. And that occurs with the renewal of your mind. Again, this is a thing that the Holy Spirit works inside of all believers to do, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God. You know what's crazy? There are a lot of individuals who say, well, man, I don't know what God's will is for my life. Well, if you don't spend time with God, you're never going to know his will because you're never going to figure out his nature. And that's the truth. Like people, I used to hate it when pastors would get up inside of church and say, read your Bible and then never give you the why. Man, you just got to read it because it's what we're supposed to do. Well, here's the what's we're supposed to do portion of it. This is the why behind it. Because you figure out more about who God is and his character. So that way when you're put in moments where you got to go, man, is this of God or is this not of God? You know what is of God and you know what is not of God. Again, he's working every good and perfect thing inside of those who are called according to his purpose. And what is good, what is acceptable, and what is perfect. And we get to see that, again, these things are occurring, and perfection, again, we have to look at this from a biblical, or what's the biblical perspective on perfection? It's wholly obeying what God's will is for your life. Again, not this thing that you yourself climb the ladder to be able to go and achieve. And this is something that's so imperative too. This is a little bit of a side note. When we read these words, oftentimes we interject what these words mean in our cultural context instead of understanding what they meant in a biblical context. We project into the scripture instead of listening and receiving. Okay, so here's what I mean. God's word is the living, breathing word of God. If it's living and breathing and it's communicating to us, that means that we have to listen to it, not speak into it. And so we listen to it, we understand what it says, and then we communicate it to other people. As we continue to wind down, this is one of the last big, broad steps in this process, fulfilling the Great Commission. So once you're born again, once you are walking through the sanctification process, the same message that you received, the same message that you accepted, the same message that you cling to in all faith and in all hope, you yourself are supposed to go out and fulfill it. And this is that message that comes from Matthew 28. This is what it says. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority, and all means all, and that's all means, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. So Jesus has all authority. And so he sets the stage. That's the foundation. I've got all authority in heaven and on earth. It's been given to me by my Father. And then here's what verse 19 says. Go, therefore, it's a proclamation and a command, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Son, or in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So we get to see here very quickly that there's an instruction, there's a process. You are to make disciples. Us as believers in Christ, we are to go and make disciples and teach people how to understand God's word, to listen, to be able to understand his will, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And verse 20, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, and this is the most beautiful part about this commission, I am with you always. What does always mean? Always. To the end of the age. So once God is residing in you, once you've made Jesus the Lord of your life, he is with you always, all the way to the end of the age. And in pride, here's what we say. We say, there's no way that somebody could be with me to the end of the age. And inside of this culture too, specifically, again, when we've seen a lot of loss, we've seen a lot of friendships, we've seen a lot of people just move on with life. If people in our own material lives, again, keep moving and keep going and keep leaving me, how could somebody actually stay with me always when all I've ever seen is people die and leave and just loss in my life? And that's weighty. And we want to care for that. We want to care for the individuals who wrestle through that. But man, we have a Father, again, through the sacrifice and through the sending of his Son, who literally made a proclamation through his Son that he will be with us always, even to the end of the age. And we get to see this beautiful thing that gets observed, that Christ and his love and through sacrifice on the cross, we are able to faithfully walk in this posture of humble obedience with somebody who's never going to leave us and who's never going to forsake us. And I'm sorry, there have been a lot of people, man. There have been people in the church who have been forsaken. There have been members on church staff who have done a lot of forsaking. There have been individuals inside of your respective lives that have forsook you. But you have somebody who is never, ever, ever going to forsake you. And all we are called to do is live a life that is holy, an obedient and faithful life, according to what God's word says and according to what his Son instructed. So this is our goal for today. The purpose of our lives should not be to make our name remembered, but to make the name of Jesus known. If our posture is trying to make our name remembered as believers, we're missing it. Like, I don't want to be remembered by, and again, we've done this whole study on this tree leading up to our Christmas Eve gathering. We've done this whole study on the tree. Man, I don't want to be remembered inside of the church. I want to be one of the individuals that we get to see here inside of the scripture specifically, like like a Abiud. Like, we don't know anything about a Abiud, okay? Like, we don't, aside from him being inside of, again, Jesus' line, we don't know anything about Eliakim. We don't know anything about Azor. We don't know anything about Zadok. We don't know anything about Achim. We don't know anything about Abiud. We don't know anything about Eleazar or Matthan or Jacob. Like, I want to be one of those individuals, and that should be our desire too. We play a role inside of a story for a specific season and for a specific time. And then once that role is done, man, it's documented inside of the Lamb's Book of Life. We were obedient. We followed God's instructions wholeheartedly. And then we're done. We're good. Man, I our burden like should be, man, like when we were making disciples, I want the people who I disciple to be more known than me. Whatever my ceiling is in this life, man, that should be the floor of the individuals who you were discipling. This right here is a great quote. I don't know who made the quote. I heard it from one of the individuals when I was doing ministry with. Our posture should be this: live, die, be forgotten. And you've lived in a really good life. If you've lived, if you've died, and if you've been forgotten. Because you've made the name of Jesus known. And that's what we have to do to be disciples of Christ, to make the name of Jesus known. Now, as we transition to this posture of prayer, I want to remind you of two really cool opportunities here at the church. The first is this that's coming up again on December 23rd, which is Christmas Laud. Some of you might be going, well, what is Christmas Laud? All right, Christmas Laud is an opportunity that we have to come together to be able to worship. This is going to be a time of carols. We're asking that, again, you bring every single member of the congregation, bring their favorite Christmas treat, a little hand, I don't know what you call them, finger food. There we go, that's the word. Little finger food that you can come and you can bring. And we're going to break bread and fellowship with one another while singing Christmas songs and reading some of our favorite Christmas passages of Scripture. We're also doing something really cool for all of the kids that are going to be there. It's called Christingle. I know some of you are like, well, what in the world is Christingle? Like, what is that? All this is this is just an object lesson for our kids. It involves an orange, it involves some skewers and some gummies and a red ribbon. And all we're doing is we're telling them the story about how God sent his son to earth in an object lesson. We're going to do it for all families as well. And then on December 24th at 10:30 a.m., this is our Christmas Eve gathering. Guys, Christmas Laud and Christmas Eve are perfect times. If you have individuals who do not know who Jesus is, who have not, again, know anything about who Christ is whatsoever, man, those are two perfect opportunities to go and invite them to be a part of, again, this fellowship of believers. Again, just to be able to come in and to become and rub shoulders and worship and sing songs of praise. And then again, on December 31st, we're going to be online for our Epiphany service. We'll have more details about that. But I'm going to turn things over to Pastor Dave, and he's going to lead us in our time of prayer.
All right. Awesome, awesome word. Let's continue worshiping with the giving of our tithes and offerings. If I could please have the ushers come forward. Father, I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to worship you in this manner of giving back to you just a portion of what you've given us. Father, I thank you, Lord, for the gifts. And I thank you, Father, for those that feel led to give. We ask your blessing upon this, a blessing upon those who give, and a blessing upon these tithes and offerings. We thank and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I just love the Christmas season because you get to read and hear all the familiar passages that sometimes you don't even hear or read about throughout the rest of the year. And it's just amazing to know that we have a risen Savior that came to earth as a baby and ministered, brought hope, brought peace, brought joy into this world. And we thank you for that this morning. Now, if you would please stand with me as we pray over the offering. Father, we thank you, Lord, for these gifts that you've brought. We thank you, Father, for all the blessings that we have here in this ministry because of people that support, not only by prayer, but by gifts and offerings. And Lord, we just pray and commit these offerings to you, Lord, that you will, Father, give us the wisdom to fulfill your purpose and plan for this ministry and this community. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now that we prayed over the offering, let us pray over you. This is a time where we come together as a family and we come alongside one another, pray for one another, and pray with one another. The altars are open. We're going to have prayer partners So feel free to come forward in prayer as we finish the service today. Lord, I thank you for each and every one here. I thank you, Father, for the love that you have for each and every one. No matter where they're at, no matter what needs they have, we know, Father, that you are the one that meets every and every need in our lives. That we can come to you, Father, through prayer and just commune with you, seeking you answers for our problems. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
You got to stop holding back. Just let it go. Just let it go, sister. All right. Stop holding back. That's awesome, isn't it? Amen. Thank you so much. My name is Fred. I'm one of the leaders here at City Point Church. We're so glad to have you with us in the house and online. Hey, don't forget about your Advent devotional. It's out there in the foyer. Grab one for 20 days. It stays through the Advent season. All right. It's so good to be in God's house today. Let me remind you of a couple things that's going on. First of all, students, tonight is your Christmas party. 5 o'clock, students, middle school, high school students upstairs is your Christmas party. It's going to be good. Heard it involves French fries. I'm excited, okay? It's going to be good. All right, so be there 5 o'clock, students, okay? What else we got going on? Christmas season, Pastor Aaron already talked about it. Man, pick one of those. Pick all three of those. Grab some family. Grab some friends. Grab some coworkers. Invite them to this thing. Christmas time's a neutral time where people can come in and see what's going on and hear the message and story of Christ. So bring them on to our Christmas Lord and our gathering. And, of course, Epiphany is online. Of course, he told you that one. All right. Also, Larry will be in the lobby. Thank you in advance. It doesn't happen until the end of February, 1st of March, for our strawberry parking. So thank you for signing up. We have morning shifts and evening shifts, and we need all the volunteers we can get to raise some funds. And all the funds go to our next home, the place where God is moving us to next, because we're just renters here. God's got another place for us. We're very excited about that, okay? Oh, go ahead and have a seat if you would. I meant to tell you that. Go ahead and have a seat if you would. All right. Pastor Jerry is coming this way. He's right there. All right.
Hey, as we close service today, let's just remember the third week of Advent, which is joy. Because the opposite of joy is hopelessness. And sometimes in this season, we have a lot of people that seem very hopeless. So would you stand with me as I give you the benediction, and then you guys will be released. Go in peace, being the light of the world and the joy to people, the joy to your friends, your family, and those you may not know. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Have a blessed week.